Welcome to the age of artificial photosynthesis.
The inherent efficiency of the process is almost 1,000 times better than plants. This is super cool.
This is the machine that could make drilling for oil obsolete.
We'll be making cheap synthetic natural gas, energy abundance, unconditional, forever, which also happens to be carbon neutral.
Why do this?
You cannot rely on fossil carbon for infinite source of energy forever. Not enough in the crust. So we have to figure out how to get out of the air.
Sorry, Mario, your princess is in another castle. This one is full of methane. This is Hard Reset. This is a plant. You've heard of plants before. They keep us alive. Plants use sunlight to suck CO2 out of the air. Then they combine it with water and store energy as chemicals like glucose, starches, or other carbohydrates. And as a nice side effect, they spit out oxygen, which we breathe. Well, what if you had a machine that did all of that? And instead of making glucose, it made methane, a fuel you could use to run a car, an airplane, or even a spaceship. Well, I flew down to Burbank, California, and stormed this castle to find the people who made that machine a reality. Meet Casey. He's a recovering physicist and the founder of Terraform Industries.
I'm a recovering physicist in the sense that I no longer earn my daily bread doing physics. Physics is actually a terrific discipline. On the other hand, most physicists work in academia, so they are typically vastly underpaid relative to their earning potential in other areas.
Yeah, Casey wanted to get paid. Now that might seem crass, but money is a big part of this story.
3 years ago, I founded Terraform Industries to make cheap synthetic natural gas from sunlight and air, thus displacing fossil hydrocarbons as the default source of humanity's energy. Over time, I did more research and experimentation on this in my garage, and I came to the horrifying realization that I would have to do it myself.
This is where the money comes in. Casey realized that all the people trying to make synthetic fuels were going about it the wrong way. Lots of bleeding-edge tech that relied on rare elements or expensive materials. The only way for this to work at scale is if it's super cheap and reliable.
Yeah, the thing about energy is that people just want it as cheaply as they can possibly get it. People have been making synthetic fuels for hundreds of years. They had coal and they could convert coal into oil, but it is unable to produce oil at anything like the quality or cost that fossil oil and gas can deliver. There's no prize for making gasoline for $50 a gallon. At the end of the day, you make it as cheap or cheaper, or you may as well not bother.
These older methods for making synthetic fuels rarely made economic sense because, well, you needed energy to make the process happen. And at the time, the cheapest energy source was fossil fuels. So you were just burning fossil fuels to make a different kind of fuel. No bueno. But now that the price and efficiency of solar panels have improved so dramatically, the economics are totally different.
Solar photovoltaic power has become cheap enough just in the last few years to enable us to convert it into natural gas, into oil products, more cheaply than it is to drill a hole in the ground and get it out and refine it and transport it halfway around the world.
Holy cats, that would change everything.
Solar's only going to continue getting cheaper. So in more and more markets worldwide, solar and solar synthetic fuels will have a clear cost advantage over ever depleting supplies of fossil oil.
This would flip the energy world upside down. It would mean that solar power wouldn't just run your electric appliances. It could also be used to make the fuel for things like trucks, airplanes, and industrial processes, even spaceships.
I have a really good friend who, when I started this company, said, so the way you're going to solve carbon capture at scale is by making more oil and gas. That seems directionally incorrect to me.
Terraform Industries is trying to show to the world that we can use hydrocarbons, specifically methane, right now, without contributing to global warming.
This is Stephanie, an expert in explosions. Actually, I know. Dream job.
So yes, my background is in combustion.
That's a nice skill to have when you work at a place that makes explosive gas, like methane, out of an even more explosive gas, like hydrogen.
So I'm constantly thinking like, okay, like what in our process could accidentally cause an explosion?
Like kerosene and gasoline, methane is a flammable fuel. It gets a bit of a bad rap because it's something produced in our digestive system, so we tend to associate it with Well, farts.
There are no odors in synthetic methane. So have there been any bad smells here?
No, none. No. I mean, there was one, but that was me. No.
So yeah, methane is odorless. All the smells you associate with methane are things like hydrogen sulfide or other contaminants. In fact, when you burn pure methane, the only byproducts are carbon dioxide and water, neither of which are toxic.
What we're doing here at Terraform Industries is recycling the CO2 that is in the atmosphere. We end up producing synthetic methane, which then gets burned up and then goes back into the atmosphere in the form of CO2. And this process repeats itself over and over again.
So even though their fuel releases CO2 into the atmosphere, it's all carbon dioxide that they'd pulled from the atmosphere in the first place. That's what they mean by carbon neutral. That's very different from burning fossil fuels. They're pulled up from the ground, and burning them adds carbon dioxide to the atmosphere that had been previously locked up in the crust for millions and millions of years. Casey's plan is to make this machine cheap and reliable enough that we just make the fuels we need instead of drilling for them. Basically, photosynthesis on an industrial scale.
We have to take what plants have done forever and improve upon that process so that there's enough energy for humans to do what they need to do.
We're making a bet that the cost of solar will continue to decrease, and therefore we'll have access to incredibly cheap electricity. So in the design and build of this machine, we're focusing on ultra low cost and not placing too much emphasis on energy efficiency. We just need to be able to build these machines, deploy them, learn from our mistakes, iterate on them, and deploy new ones. They're good enough, they're inefficient, but they work.
So how do they work? This machine has three main components. An electrolyzer, which uses electricity to split water into hydrogen and oxygen, a carbon capture system that pulls carbon dioxide out of the air, and a Sabatier reactor that puts them all together to make methane. Here is the electrolyzer. I'm going to let Stephanie explain it because she actually understands it.
So water is being split into hydrogen and oxygen. We've designed it to be simple in terms of the design and assembly. The cell is just two nickel electrodes, a separator that is there to prevent oxygen and hydrogen from mixing to avoid creating this flammable environment. The oxygen, we don't care what happens to that, we just vent it. At the end of the day, we've been able to build an electrolyzer that has a gas purity of about 99.8%, which is good enough for our reactor. I'm gonna keep repeating that phrase, good enough. It's good enough for our reactor.
So this process gets you your hydrogen, mm-hmm. You get rid of the oxygen. Mm-hmm. Without hydrogen, you need CO2. So how do you get your carbon dioxide?
We take it out of the air the same way plants do.
Okay, can we say you do that?
Yeah.
Great. This is the carbon capture system. It looks like rocks on a conveyor belt because it's rocks on a conveyor belt.
We start out with limestone, the material that absorbs CO2 from the atmosphere.
The material comes in at one end and takes about 2 days to come off the other end. At the same time, the air that's being blown through is roaring through at high speed. So over the course of that time, it's equivalent to something like 30 miles of air passes through this bed.
So they make calcium hydroxide out of that limestone and put it on the conveyor belt. And along the way, it soaks up CO2 and becomes calcium carbonate. They put that into a kiln and bake it, and that CO2 will come off as a gas, and they're able to use that in their process. What they're left with is calcium oxide. They can actually just turn that back into calcium hydroxide by mixing it with water. Then it goes back on the conveyor belt. Science!
And that's where the cake mixer comes in.
That's where the cake mixer comes in, yeah.
I'm especially fond of any process that involves the misuse of a cake mixer.
I meant to do that. You can taste shards of glass. Yummy.
We're currently developing a more sophisticated and more effective solvent regeneration process, but mm-hmm. Cake mixer got us there for the most recent demo. And we should put it on a pedestal someday. Thank you, cake mixer.
I mean, you could also just use it to make cakes.
We avoided the warranty pretty thoroughly.
Anyway, we have our main ingredients now, carbon dioxide and hydrogen, together at last. They get pushed into this reactor and then something happens. No one actually knows.
You're creating a new form of matter. Before our very eyes, inside this tiny little tube right here.
What makes that reaction happen? What's the catalyst?
No one knows. I mean, I know what the catalyst is, but the way the catalyst works, no one actually really knows for sure.
Huh.
But it's called the Sabatier reaction. It was discovered in 1897 by a very accomplished French physicist. Essentially, hydrogen sticks to the nickel, CO2 comes by, bumps into it, and the hydrogens proceed to rip the oxygens off the carbon atom until there's just a carbon atom left over, and then that sticks to the hydrogens and rolls around a bit like that Japanese video game until it's got four hydrogens and it pops off as a gas.
It's actually magic. That's the word we generally use for science we don't understand yet. So there you go. Anyway, the output that this thing is all made for is methane. You might not think methane is very cool. I mean, I'm also making methane in my stomach all day long, and no one seems to want to buy that. But methane is an amazing fuel, and it can do things that electricity can't. We currently pipe it into millions of homes for cooking and heating. We use it to run some cars and trucks, and even to launch rockets into space.
Natural gas is an incredible product for transporting energy, and it's not going away. Even if you hope that in 100 years we've electrified the entire economy, even if that was possible. In the meantime, we've still got to move away from drilling as fast as we can. Here's one of the samples that we took here in March this year. So this is Terraform Industries fossil carbon-free synthetic natural gas made in the United States, 97.1% purity. There it is in our hands. It's like, I have three children, so I've experienced this feeling four times. It's pretty special. I think it's a real testament to the strength and the determination of the team here to basically do this. No one has ever made pipeline grade synthetic natural gas using low cost, ultra low capex methodology. We're the only people on earth who've ever done it. What comes out of the ground has actually got way more contaminants in it than what we produce. And if you're making natural gas from biological waste products like dairy farm waste or whatever, it also has a bunch of contaminants in it. All that stuff has to be filtered out before it goes into the gas line. In our case, what comes out of a machine is good enough to go into the gas line straight away.
One thing that you should know about this process is that it's pretty inefficient, and that's actually okay.
We are developing a solution that we can implement today to address climate change.
The Terraformer is probably the least efficient synthetic fuel process that's ever been seriously contemplated, as far as we know. And in fact, it's about 30 to 35% efficient at converting electricity into natural gas. Is that good? Is that bad? The machine itself costs money, and to improve efficiency incrementally, you have to increase the expense or the cost or the complexity of the machine exponentially.
There's a much more efficient version of this machine that could be made with today's technology. But that version would also cost far more. So much more that this inefficient version is actually better.
What we're building is a synthetic fuel system of the people, a machine that we can scale up into the tens or hundreds of millions as quickly as possible. It does not have to be perfect. It does not have to have the maximum possible efficiency. So if anything, over time, I would expect the efficiency to decrease further in order to reduce cost.
Another thing to consider is that while some versions of this machine might work really well in perfect conditions, the Terraformer is sort of designed to work in any condition. That's good because the places you might want to set it up and run it could vary wildly.
It doesn't care if the sun goes down. It doesn't care if it's an incredibly sunny day. It will produce a bunch of hydrogen or small amount of hydrogen or no hydrogen. But it will never reach the point where unsafe conditions are created inside of the electrolyzer.
The next step for Terraform Industries is to get this technology deployed and working in the field and show that it actually makes money.
This is the critical step. You actually have to make money. You actually have to produce more value for humanity than you consume. Would I rather spend this money drilling holes in the ground and hoping that gas comes back out and I make my money back, which is like roughly 25% chance? Or would I rather put this into building 200, 300, 400 megawatts of terraformers, which will produce the same amount of gas with practically zero risk and the same return? And it's very clear to me that, like, given the choice, you'd rather reduce your risk. Start switching over to terraformers as quickly as we can pump them out of this factory.
So picture a scenario where we don't need to drill into the earth to get the fuel that we need. That's important for a lot of reasons. For one thing, we wouldn't be reliant on a fuel source that was hard to get to, had a finite supply, and resulted in undesirable side effects. It would mean cleaner air and less pollution, but we wouldn't need to rebuild our energy infrastructure from scratch.
We're literally looking at projects where we deploy our system on top of gas wells. and then plumbing to them. And we're actually helping the operator there make more money because we're continuing to use the infrastructure they've deployed to take gas out of the ground and put it into our pipelines.
And methane is just the beginning. It's theoretically possible to synthesize almost any hydrocarbon you can think of.
We do want to diversify our synthetic fuels portfolio. This is the first step, but we do plan to deploy a methanol pilot plant and eventually transition to being able to make sustainable aviation fuels.
This is also a technology we'll need to master before we settle on places like the moon or Mars, because there's probably not a lot of fossil fuels there to begin with. But this isn't just about the far future. This is about now. This is about a world of energy abundance without the threat of climate change.
If we execute sensibly here, by the 2040s, every man, woman, and child on Earth will have quantities, qualities, and prices of oil and gas products that we take for granted here in the United States. Vast reductions in air pollution, vast reductions in solar heating from additional CO2 exploitation. It definitely is a full-throated recognition of the fact that humans have the ability to regulate the content of their atmosphere and the temperature of the surface of the Earth. There is a thermostat that we have our hand on.
In short, it's hard to think of a downside to a technology that can literally deliver energy out of thin air. Thanks for watching Hard Reset. If you want to see more stories of how the future is being built, subscribe to our channel.